Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Equipment Leasing and Finance 101 webinar being presented by Alfredo Donelson, that would be me, and Ken Weinberg of the Baker Donelson Law Firm. We are very pleased to have you attend the webinar today and hope hopefully you'll be able to take away some things that you didn't know when you entered the webinar, or perhaps we've refreshed your memory with some other things. This is Equipment Leasing and Finance 101, so it is briefly covering a number of topics that are important in the equipment leasing and finance world. We could probably take any one of these topics and spend an hour or several hours on them alone. But hopefully we'll give you enough to take away to make it all worthwhile. My colleague in the presentation is Ken Weinberg. He's a shareholder here at Baker Donelson and has been in the industry for too many years to count right now, although he's not as old as I am. A key component of Ken's practice involves the representation of lenders and investors and borrowers and developers in connection with recourse and non-recourse construction loans, project finance, and regular equipment financing transactions. I've been around for some 30 years and have been involved in equipment finance the entire time, everything from construction equipment to manufacturing equipment, aircraft, vessels, you name it. And we welcome you here today. Let me start off by one other thing I should mention is that Baker Donelson is steeped in equipment finance lawyers, people who specialize in aircraft, people who specialize in vessels, and all types of other types of equipment. Let me just touch on a couple or a few housekeeping items. Number one, the slide deck for today's presentation will be made available to all the participants, and you should have them within the next day or so. There should be a questions tab on your screen. All questions will be answered at the end of the presentation, but you should submit your questions via the questions tab, and then we will collect them and attempt to answer all of them or as many as we can before the end of the time slot. There are also speaker bios if you need to contact or wish to contact Ken or myself. And finally, there will be a survey that will pop up at the end of the presentation, and we invite you to please fill that out and let us know how we can improve for future presentations. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Ken and let him start us off with the webinar. So Ken, go right ahead.
Hi, everybody. This is Ken Weinberg. Thanks for attending. Alfredo is a little too modest to toot his own horn, but not to make him feel old, I do consider him to be a fixture in the industry. For example, he's currently on the legal committee of the Equipment Leasing and Finance Association, which is one of the premier associations in the industry that helps to provide education, lobbying, and otherwise shape equipment leasing and finance. Alfredo is also a tremendous source of knowledge in a variety of areas and true battle-tested experience. So I'm honored to be on the panel with him. We're going to start talking about the industry just generally. It is one of the most popular forms of finance in the United States. The last numbers I had that were definitive were for 2014, and you'll see it was approximately a $900 billion industry just in the U.S. ELFA does projections, that's Equipment Leasing and Finance Association. They do projections, and they're usually pretty accurate. And for 2015 through 2017, they're anticipating a little over $1 trillion a year as an industry just in the United States. Now, Alfredo and I are going to focus on some specific discrete legal issues like he mentioned, but first thought we'd take a step back to kind of look at the industry generally, for fear that if you focus too much on individual items, you might miss the forest for the trees. And to beat an analogy to death, as I'm known to do, it's an industry with very deep historic roots, so it's important to understand that perspective. The key point I want to make is that it's not traditional bank financing. We have a lot of people on this call with different ranges of experience, so for some of you, this will be a good way of getting kind of a better walking around feel for the industry. But even the most experienced equipment leasing and finance professionals on the call can benefit from reminding themselves of the origin and evolution of our financial products. It's because of this background that credit officers, relationship managers, asset managers, lawyers like Alfredo and I, all who have equipment leasing and finance experience, come at these transactions through a special, unique lens. And having been around for about 20 years doing this, I'm a little biased, and I like to think of the lens as a pair of really cool shades. The earliest equipment financing transactions in the United States date back to the 1870s, and these were basically done through trust, equipment trust that would issue certificates and were used to finance big transportation equipment, barges, railroad cars, locomotives, things like that. And to this day, you'll still see trust used in equipment leasing and finance transactions that are more structured or in certain unique circumstances. I have a couple of examples here on this next slide, which I won't go through a lot of detail on. But you'll see on the left side is a leverage lease. This is a typical structure that uses a trust. And in these transactions, the actual lessor is an owner trust. It's a trust, usually a Delaware statutory trust. Sometimes you still see a common law trust. And the leasing company will be called an equity investor or an owner participant. And it will just have an interest in the trust, a beneficial interest in the trust. The trust will be disregarded for tax purposes so that all the tax benefits and income and all that will flow through up to the equity participant. But in order to get, you know, the biggest bang for its buck and put in as little cash as possible to still get the tax benefits, it'll cause the owner trust to borrow up to 80% of the purchase price of the equipment. And that's what the leverage is that we're talking about. And you'll see on the left where the debt is. And sometimes that debt structure is also through a trust. So you can get indentured trustees and pass-through trustees and all sorts of fun stuff. Over on the right side is another sort of trust structure that you sometimes see. This is a titling trust. And a titling trust is used by leasing companies who originate a lot of motor vehicle transactions and intend to syndicate or sell or otherwise assign them. And they want to avoid having to retitle the assets with every leg of the transaction. So again, in the top box, you'll see that the lessor is again a trust, a titling trust, and the leasing company has a beneficial interest in the trust. Then when the leasing company decides to sign or sell or syndicate one or more leases, if you look in the bottom box, it'll create a sub-trust and put the specific leases and the related equipment, the related vehicles into that sub-trust, and it can sell the beneficial interest in that sub-trust to the assignee or assign it as collateral for a non-recourse loan, a kind of a typical syndication process. But by using this trust structure, they're able to sell what is essentially personal property, a beneficial interest in a trust. The lessor remains the trust, and therefore the titles don't have to change. Again, these are just a couple of examples of how kind of the history of the industry still shapes the way it is currently. Truly modern equipment leasing began to hit its main stride in the 1950s with the introduction of the depreciation system to the Internal Revenue Code. Now, depreciation is basically the ability of an owner of equipment to amortize or expense the equipment cost over a certain period of time, 3, 5, 7 or more years, depending on the type of equipment, the asset class. When this came into effect, it really spurred leasing because you had a lot of companies who didn't have what I would call a tax appetite. They didn't have enough revenue to be able to take advantage of these tax benefits, so they would go to another party, and the lessor, and ask the lessor to acquire the equipment, lease it to the customer under a long-term lease, and as the owner of the equipment, the lessor could take the tax benefits and pass on some of those benefits through a better rental rate, et cetera, to the lessee. So what is a lease? Just to start back it down to Disney, is I have a short definition here. It's an arrangement where one person, the lessor, owns an asset and provides the possession and use of the asset to another person, the lessee, for a fixed term. Now, you're probably seeing much more complicated definitions. One of the most famous ones is in the UCC, 1203 in most states, 120137 in some. And it helps distinguish a lease from a loan, and Alfredo will talk about that more later. In consideration for this lease, what the lessor gets for giving possession and use to the lessee is its return on its investment. But it's not like lending principal and collecting interest. There's more components to it. So first, the lessor will receive rent. And again, this is a payment for possession and use of the equipment. It is not principal and interest. It's not subject to usury limitations or other sort of legal concepts surrounding loans. It is just like when you go to Hertz Rent-A-Car and rent the car for the day, except for it's a longer-term lease. At the end of the term of the lease, the lessee will either buy the equipment or give it back under some circumstances, in which case the lessor can resell or release it. And this is another part of return. It's kind of like a balloon on a note, except for instead of just the credit risk of can the lessee make a payment on a balloon or a debtor make a payment on a balloon, you have the issue of what's the equipment worth. But there is value there, and we call that the residual interest, and that's another component. And then, of course, there's the tax benefits, which we've talked about briefly. So I'm kind of highlighting them all here in red just to hammer home the point. And this is why in leases you'll see things like liquidated damages formula or stipulated loss value tables, casualty value tables. It's not as simple as saying it's principal and interest on a note plus a prepayment penalty. You have these other components. And there's, you know, various computer programs that can run these numbers for leasing companies. But in order to have something contractually in the document, you need to either have a very well-crafted formula or preferably some sort of table that outlines what equipment is worth at different points during the transaction. Now, of course, the lessor's goal is to get its return on its investment, but with as minimal risk as possible. So leases always have provisions in them that put obligations on the lessee that you would expect the lessee to have if they were the owner of the equipment. For example, the lessee is responsible for taxes. The lessor may have to file the taxes as the owner of equipment, depending, but the lessee is still responsible for it at the end of the day. Insurance is paid for by the lessee. Maintenance is all the lessee's responsibility. If the equipment is destroyed and subject to a casualty occurrence or an event of loss, that's also on the lessee, and Alfredo will talk about some of these later as well. But you still have this residual risk sitting out there. And, of course, that's a pretty big matzo ball. So lessors started to push the envelope on the residual risk and figure out how they can minimize that risk. They're not really Hertz Rent-A-Car. They don't want the equipment back. So you'd see a variety of options. I haven't seen a First Amendment lease in quite some time, but just by way of an example, it's a transaction where at the end of the lease term, the original term, the lessee can buy the equipment for maybe fair market value or fixed price. And if it doesn't buy it, it cannot return the equipment. It's got to renew the lease for another year or another 2 years. And the idea is the lessor was forcing more money to come in through rent rather than as residual. Another example is a dollar purchase option. Most people in this virtual room will know what that is, essentially where the lessee can buy it for a dollar. And who in the world is not going to buy something for a dollar at the end of the term, you know, unless it's hazardous or something? That's why you have all these knickknacks in the grocery store line. Everybody likes something for a dollar or less. Other techniques used were difficult return conditions. You could have a very small window. Some lessors would use a small window where the lessee had to notify, you know, 180 days out from the end of the lease term, but no more than 210 days, some very narrow window. And if they didn't provide the notice that they're going to return the equipment and they elected to buy it automatically, or you'd have requirements that the equipment has to be certified prime ship maintenance or some sort of extended warranty program. You'd have, you know, conditions that require return anywhere in the continental United States. You know, I see, Mr. Lessee, you're located in Florida. We're going to need this back to our remarketing center up in Seattle. So, you know, lessors would push the envelope here. I cross out evergreen lease because that's not something that, it's not crossed out on this. Well, it's red, and it should be crossed out. An evergreen lease is not the type of thing anybody in this room would do, but these were used in some transactions back in the day. Essentially, you'd have a lease with a whole bunch of addenda and complicated provisions, and if you trace everything around in a big circle, you discover the lessee can never actually give the equipment back. So anyway, these were the types of transactions where the lessors were pushing the envelope. So the question arises, if the lessor is buying the equipment from the vendor solely to lease to the lessee, it's delivered to the lessee on day one, the lessee has it for the entire term, and then at the end of the term, the lessee is going to own it because it's a dollar out lease or some other reason, then is it really a lease? And all these descriptions I have on this slide are what's used to describe this sort of transaction. I don't like some of these terms, and you'll see I've made some notes here, but you'll hear them all. So it's good to kind of see them. A dollar out lease, I think, is a great description, if that's really what it is, a dollar purchase option. A non-tax lease or a non-true lease is also a very good description. Capital lease, you'll sometimes hear, that's really an accounting term. Dirty leases and disguised security interests just feel kind of dirty and sneaky, so I don't like those. Financing lease, you'll hear that phrase a lot, And it's very descriptive. It's a financing, but unfortunately, it's a special kind of true lease under Article 2A of the Uniform Commercial Code, where it's a three-party transaction where the lessor is buying the equipment from the vendor solely to lease to a lessee. So it's not really a good description to talk about these non-true or non-tax leases, although some people still use it. And then leases intended as security, or alias, which stands for a lease intended as security, those imply that intent is relevant, and it's not anymore, as Alfredo will talk about some when he talks about purchase options. So the law, of course, and accounting and other rules have, you know, caught on, and there are specific rules to describe these transactions as not being leases. And a matter of fact, the majority of transactions that say they're a lease are actually just a secured loan. What's interesting, though, are there are different tests for accounting. General commercial law, which is state law, which is what applies in bankruptcy. The bankruptcy code will defer to local state law. And for tax law, the accounting test is what you'd expect from a bunch of accountants. It's very formulaic, very number-driven. We'll take the discounted present value of future rent using the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. And if it's more than 90% of the original equipment cost, it's not a true lease. You look at the economic life of the equipment. If it's more than 75%, if the term of the lease is more than 75% of the equipment's economic life, it's not a lease. Very number intensive. The commercial law test is what you'd expect from a bunch of lawyers. And it's a very mushy, gooey analysis. There purports to be a bright line under the UCC, but then we bury the bright line with a whole bunch of facts and circumstances, analysis, and gibbledygook that makes it hard to say definitively whether or not you're in one category or another. And then the tax law test is what you would expect from kind of in the middle from lawyers that actually know how to do math. And it's kind of a blend of the two. You have some facts and circumstances, substance over form analysis, but you also have some formulas and descriptions. For example, with the leverage lease, when I mentioned, you can have more than 80% debt. Now, what's interesting is you can actually kind of skirt between these different tests. And you can have some tests that are true leases for one purpose and not for another. And the classic example is a synthetic lease. This is a loan for tax purposes and a lease for accounting purposes. Some people call them off-balance sheet loans. But the point is that the tests are not all the same. If you get into state and local tax issues, you can end up with even crazier tests because you got the different state taxing authorities, and they're all across the board as well. Sometimes a dollar purchase option is different than a $101 purchase option, for example. So some people in the industry over the last probably decade or so have started to morph and not use leases that are not true leases. They've instead started to talk in terms of lender and borrower to get out of some of the state and local tax issues and lessor liability. Why not call a duck instead of a monkey? If this thing isn't really a lease, let's use the right vernacular. And so you'll see equipment finance agreements. You'll see master loan and security agreements. Sometimes they have promissory notes. Sometimes they don't. But the point that you want to remember is these are all kind of born and evolved from the equipment leasing background. So they focus in on equipment and attack issues with the historical perspective of equipment leasing. So why do customers like to do equipment leasing and finance? For true leases, there's some items that are unique to true leases, and that's to deal with the tax benefits. Customers who have a net operating loss and can't use the tax benefits, or have very expensive equipment compared to their overall balance sheet. Airlines are likely to lease because airplanes are so expensive, for example. Or in industries where you have tax incentives, for example, in renewable energy transactions, you have investment tax credits and production tax credits. In all these areas, leasing provides a way to essentially monetize those tax benefits. There's also a balance sheet effect. This is changing some. Currently, true operating leases are not reported on the balance sheet. They're just a footnote. There is some changes coming in December of 2018 for public companies and December of 2019 for private companies. All leases will basically be put on the balance sheet, but they're still going to be partially off balance sheet because what goes on the balance sheet will just be the rental portion during the term, not the residual. In addition, they won't be having kind of depreciation benefits and imputed interest and all those things that are present in a loan transaction. So it'll still be favorable to have a lease for balance sheet purposes, and it'll still continue to be popular for that reason. And, of course, there's just day-to-day asset management convenience. Much to my wife's dismay, I'm a bit of a car junkie, and, you know, every 2 or 3 years I get an itch and I want a new car. And, you know, I lease my car because in, you know, 25 months from now, I know I'm going to walk into the dealer, drop off the keys, and get something different. And it's convenient and it's nice. And people will do that with certain types of equipment that they turn over regularly or equipment that has a technological component. So that's another reason. But remember, you know, the majority of these things aren't actually tax leases and these other items don't apply, but it's still very popular. These next couple slides show the various items that are popular for just equipment financings or leases that are non-true leases. One, they're generally 100% financing for a variety of reasons, and there's not loan-to-value requirements requiring the lessee or borrower to put in 20% or something. They also tend to be very quick, effective, and inexpensive compared to traditional bank financing. They tend to be form-driven, and there's often something like a master agreement. So you can have your general terms and conditions in a master, and then each individual lease or loan is a schedule that incorporates by reference those general terms from the master, and each is a separate standalone obligation. So you can, you know, over years and years and years, do new transactions with a couple pages based on the same master. So it allows for growth and very quick and easy documentation. There's also reliance on purchase money security interest, which I'll talk about later, which make it quicker to close these transactions. And there's a robust syndication market where these schedules, as I'm describing them, or chattel paper, are sold. And those tend to be done on forms that are somewhat industry standard. They all have similar roots. And a lot of syndication partners know each other. So it's a very good way to, you know, grow a relationship and then be able to offload some of it when the lessor reaches a customer concentration or industry concentration limit. In addition, you'll run into interesting things like customer internal approval structures. There are some companies that if they want to sign a note, they got to get, you know, two levels of approval and five signatures, even if it's $50,000, or then go sign a $1 million equipment lease just from their normal kind of equipment management function. So you'll see people like it for those reasons. It frees up credit lines. You have your senior credit facility who has an all-asset lien. You really want to try to use you know, those funds for working capital or other needs rather than discrete equipment purchases if you can get that money somewhere else through equipment finance. Senior credit facilities often will have a basket to allow this sort of financing. True leases or purchase money transactions up to a certain amount will be allowed as permitted indebtedness, and those liens will be allowed as permitted liens. And the last item is you're less likely to have financial covenants, although that's not across the board. Historically, leases did not have covenants. We've seen somewhat of a shift in that, especially with bank subsidiaries in certain markets, but it's still less likely to be as layered with covenants as a loan transaction and is more focused on the equipment. I'm going to pass it now to Alfredo.
Okay, Ken, thanks a lot. Okay, let's go back. Okay, all right, I'm going to talk in this section about purchase options. One of the things Ken mentioned was that the characterization of the transaction can be described either as a true lease or as a loan. And purchase options can have a major impact on how the transaction is characterized. If it's a loan, then the rights of the secured party and its protecting its interests are governed by Article 9 of the Uniform Commercial Code. And if it turns out to be a true lease, then the rights of the parties are governed by Article 2A. But it is very important to be able to determine whether or not the transaction is a loan or a true lease. So let me go through the purchase options where it's pretty much established that they do not destroy the true lease character of the lease, and you have indeed a true lease. Probably the most popular one is the fair market value purchase option. And in this situation, at the end of the lease, the lessee has two things that it can do. It can either return the equipment to the lessor per the return conditions under the lease, or it can purchase the equipment for fair market value. And fair market value can be an amount that's determined at the parties at the end of the lease, If they can't seem to come to an agreement, then they can get an appraiser. But usually it's an amount that a willing buyer under no compulsion to buy is willing to pay, and a willing seller under no compulsion to sell is willing to sell for. And it's sort of a typical transaction where two parties come together and agree a price to buy the equipment. The next purchase option is a sort of a fixed price purchase option, and this is where we start to, you know, have to do a little bit more analysis. So long as the purchase option, the fixed price purchase option, is an amount which, when determined at the beginning of the lease, is estimated to be the fair market value of the equipment at the end of the term, then in most cases, there are some situations you have to look at the amount of useful life remaining in the equipment. But in most situations, so long as the fair market value, the fixed price purchase option, is something that, when determined at the beginning of the lease, was estimated to be the fair market value of the equipment at the end of the term, then you're well within the true lease characterization of the structure. As we move on, we come to something called the fair market value purchase option with a floor, which is something I've never seen used, quite honestly. The fair market value purchase option with the floor is a concept where you have a fixed price purchase option at the end of the lease, and that fixed price, and the lessee has the ability to purchase the equipment for the higher of fair market value and the fixed price purchase option, which to me seems that, of course, if the fair market value is less than the fixed price purchase option, it's kind of hard to understand why the lessee would purchase the equipment. However, there may be some reasons. Usually in leases, if it's equipment that's installed in a factory, then generally the lessee is required to deinstall the equipment, package it, ship it, and sort of incur that cost and expense and trouble. And if they're going to go out and buy new equipment, they then got to pay for the new equipment, have that installed, and they may just determine that when they look at the cost of deinstalling and returning the existing equipment and replacing it, it's worthwhile to go ahead and pay the higher fixed price purchase option than to go through the process and then buy new equipment. But in most instances, it seems difficult to understand why someone would pay a significantly higher fixed price option for equipment where the fair market value is substantially lower. The next couple of purchase options will be purchase options that typically result in the transaction being treated as a loan. Ken spoke earlier of the dollar purchase option. In this case, the purchase, it doesn't have to be a dollar, but if the fixed price purchase option at the end of the lease is considered to be a nominal purchase price, then in those cases, it will be characterized as a loan, and the parties will have to treat it as such and protect their interests. The lender or the lessor would have to protect his interests under Article 9 by filing in the same way it would if it had made a loan. Keep in mind that even if there's a dollar purchase option and the dollar purchase option is deemed to be reasonable, the reasonable estimate of the fair market value of the equipment at the end of the lease, it will still likely be characterized as a loan, because in that instance, it is likely that the useful economic life of the equipment will have been used. And I mean, yeah, the useful economic life of the equipment will have been utilized. And in those instances where the lessee has used up the financial useful economic life of the equipment, that's generally deemed to be a loan. So, for instance, if you have a computer that's 20 years old, it's probably, for the fair market value, is probably not worth more than a dollar. But, you know, and it may have, you know, another 10 years of useful life and able to do what it is. But the fact of the matter is, in that situation, the economic useful life of the equipment will have been used many, many years prior to that. And in a situation like that, it would be considered to be a loan. The mandatory put purchase option, okay? Well, in this situation where the lessor has the right to force the lessee to purchase the equipment. Clearly, once again, regardless of the price, it's the fact that the lessor is forcing the lessee to purchase the equipment, you would have the loan treatment. Basically, the lessor has relinquished any residual value that it might have in the equipment. It has no sort of interest in retaining the equipment. And in those instances where the residual value is rest in the lessee and not in the lessor, generally, those types of transactions will result in the financing being characterized as a loan. Now, I call this walking on the edge, although it may not be, right? In most instances, in many instances, certainly, where the remaining useful life of the equipment is sort of 20 to 25% of the equipment's useful life, and the fair market value is somewhere in the neighborhood of 20 to 25%, people have gotten comfortable that those transactions usually result in the characterization of the structure. There are situations where lessors and lessees have decided to have a fixed price purchase option that is significantly less than that. It could be 15% or 10%. And my strong suggestion is that in any situation where you have a fixed price purchase option, it's probably a very good idea to have your accountants and tax advisors very much involved in advising as to whether or not you have reached the true lease nature of the structure, if that's what you desire. I'm going to take a second to talk about sort of special purchase options. One of them is it's called a track lease. And it relates specifically to motor vehicles. There are specific laws with respect to the true leasing of motor vehicles that are governed by federal and state laws. And in this situation, a track lease contains what's called a terminal rental adjustment clause. And in essence, the lessee is given a fixed price purchase option, it's called the track amount, which must be the reasonable estimate of the fair market value of the equipment at the end of the term. Of course, that is determined at the inception of the lease. And then at the end of the term, the lessee either purchases for the track amount or assists the lessor in selling the equipment. And to the extent the sales price received from the sale of the equipment is less than the track amount, then the lessee has the obligation to top up the price in order for the lessor to receive the full track amount. And to the extent the sales price exceeds the track amount, the lessee actually gets to keep the excess. So there is some potential upside for the lessee in this type of transaction, although there is no real downside, let's say, for the lessor, because it does receive the amount that it believed would be the fair market value at the end of the lease. Although, if there was any additional upside, it sort of relinquishes that additional upside. Again, this is for these are special leases that apply to motor vehicles. There is also something called a split track lease, which is also a true lease. And in this situation, there is an upside limit on the lessee's exposure as to how much it will have to pay of the track amount, and the lessor does take some risk. So let's take an example where, you know, the track amount is $20 at the end of the lease, and the lessor takes a risk on $5. What will happen then is at the end of the lease, if the equipment is sold for $20, obviously the lessor gets the $20, everybody's happy. If the equipment sells for $10, then the lessee gets a $10 sales price, and the lessee is on the hook to top it up for an additional $10 so that the track amount of $20 is received by the lessor. Let's say the equipment sells for $2. In that situation, the lessor has already agreed that it will take a $5 risk, and that the max amount that the lessee has to pay is $15. So in a situation where the equipment were to sell for $2, then the lessee would pay the $15 that it's the maximum amount that it's obligated to pay, and the lessor would receive the $15 plus the $2 of $17, and they would have to take a hit on the additional $3 that it would take to get to the track amount. And again, these split track leases are considered to be true leases as well. A couple of other sort of special purchase options, again, which will not destroy the true lease character of the lease, these would be true leases, is where the lessee has what's called an early buyout option. And in the early buyout situation, the lessee and lessor negotiate a specific time, a specific date during the lease, where the lessee can purchase the equipment for a fixed price. And again, that fixed price, which is determined at the inception of the lease, is an amount which is estimated to be the fair market value of the equipment on that particular date. And the lessee and the lessor, they'll go out, they'll get appraisers to come and give sort of a desktop appraisal of what they expect that equipment would be worth on the early buyout date. So there's some, you know, it's not as if the two parties get together and just come up with a price. They usually have some evidence that indeed, you know, the early buyout price is a real estimate of what the fair market value will be on the early buyout date. If it turns out that happens to be incorrect, that doesn't matter. It's at the time that the lease was entered into that it was a reasonable estimate at that time. Early termination option, very similar to this. This is a situation where during the term of the lease, at some point, there may be a specific date or some date where the lessee is permitted to terminate the lease. Under normal circumstances, the lessee just can't terminate a lease. If it does, then it's got to pay, you know, it's got to do pay all the rent that would have been expected to be paid and a number of other things. But in this situation, the parties agree that the lessee can terminate the lease at some specified date. After the lessee terminates the lease and in connection with that termination, the lessee usually has an obligation to go out and find a buyer for the equipment. And the sales price to be obtained must be at least equal to some what amount which the parties agreed would be the fair market value on the date of termination. And if for some reason that amount isn't achieved, again, the lessee would have to top up to achieve that amount. If the amount received is in excess of the FMV amount, then the lessor is happy. He gets to keep the excess.
I'm going to talk for about 10 minutes about a special tool used in equipment leasing and finance. And those of you that know me know that I have a very geeky sense of humor and probably are not surprised that I take great joy in the fact that judges wearing black robes, writing Byzantine, archaic, boring stuff about Article 9 will refer to this concept as providing super priority. So I couldn't help myself. It's a bird. It's a plane. Da-da-da-da. It's a super priority purchase money security interest. And these are important concepts because, as Alfredo mentioned, sometimes what's a lease versus what's a loan can be blurry. So, you know, the traditional way of handling transactions is to always make sure that you have the first priority lien, even if you think you have a true lease product. And a purchase money security interest is a tool used by equipment leasing and finance companies to make sure this happens. They're not used in all transactions, but they are used frequently. They're sometimes called the PMSI. They're sometimes called the PIMSI. But they essentially enable the lender or lessor, I'm just going to say lender, secured party, to jump to the front of the line with respect to the purchase money collateral, even if there are other filings that predate their filing. This is one of the most famous exceptions to the first to file or perfect rule, and one of the only exceptions that applies to filing collateral. So by relying on PMSI, or a PIMSY, the secured party can avoid having to search the UCC records, get a copy, review it all, find any conflicting liens, going out and getting subordinations or UCC 3 terminations. They can just go ahead and do the transaction as long as they're PMSI compliant. But of course, the devil is in the, or the kryptonite, I guess, to use the analogy I like to use, is in the details. Now, in typical Article 9 fashion, it's not as easy to define purchase money security interest as you would think it was. Here's the actual definition. It's in three different parts. You got to put it all together. Technically, a security interest in goods is a purchase money security interest to the extent the goods are purchase money collateral with respect to that security interest, whatever that means, right? So then you go look, okay, well, what's purchase money collateral? Well, it's purchase money collateral. Goods are purchase money collateral if they secure a purchase money obligation incurred with respect to that collateral. Not much more of a help. The rubber meets the road in the definition of purchase money obligation. If you focus in on that obligation or that definition, you get a much better sense of what's going on here. And I'm going to skip to the next slide to highlight some of these words red. A purchase money obligation is an obligation of an obligor, the debtor or lessee borrower, incurred as all or part of the price of the collateral, or for value given to enable the debtor to acquire rights in or use of the collateral if the value was used, you know, for that purpose. So there's actually two things going on here. That first bit of red words, this is really an installment sale or a vendor lien. When a vendor sells goods and reserves title or takes a security interest back, that's a purchase money obligation. And in fact, a reservation of title, according to UCC 2401, is nothing more than a security interest. So you have a purchase money security interest in a lot of vendor transactions where they're, you know, doing some financing in connection with the sale. For equipment leasing finance company, it's usually the second component, which is that the funds that the lessor or lender are providing enable the debtor to acquire rights in or use of the collateral. Now, the other thing is what can be subject to a purchase money security interest. I mentioned goods in that definition, and goods are basically defined to be all things movable when a security interest attaches. And there are a variety of subclasses of goods or other types of goods. So you're used to hearing equipment and inventory. Those are the two major subclasses of goods. Fixtures are also goods. They're just goods that are so attached to real property that an interest arises in them under real property law. And software can be part of goods if they're embedded in the goods. So for example, all the computer gadgets in your car, that's just part of the goods, that's the car. The little parenthetical there about other than goods that consist solely of the medium in which the software is embedded, that's intended to get something like a CD. A software doesn't become goods because it's embedded in a CD. That doesn't quite count. In 2001, Article 9 went through a major overhaul, and you were able to get now a purchase money security interest in software, even if it's not embedded in the goods, but only in special circumstances where the software is essentially integrated and purchase an integrated transaction with the goods to be used with the goods. This is important as technological, you know, advancements continue. Think about software that comes with an MRI machine or something like that. Now, a key point is just because you have a purchase money security interest does not mean you have purchase money priority. You have to actually still jump through the hoops to be entitled to priority. And those are all in 9.324. And I'm talking about equipment here, and the rule for the equipment is that you have to be perfected no later than 20 days after the date the debtor receives possession of the collateral. Remember, perfection isn't just the filing of your UCC. It also means you have a grant of a security interest and the debtor has rights in the collateral. You have what we call attachment under Article 9. All that has to happen not later than 20 days after the date the debtor gets possession. Inventory has tighter rules, and Alfredo's going to hit that in a little while. Fixtures, I'm just mentioning here, technically fixtures could be equipment or inventory. It's kind of hard to imagine fixtures as inventory, if you think of inventory as things held for sale. But remember, inventory is also things held for lease or to be furnished or out on lease or being furnished under a contract of service. So if you had a billboard or something, you could have a fixture that's inventory and be in that set of rules. So why is a super priority rule afforded to purchase money security interest? The idea is to encourage borrowers who have already pledged their assets to be able to go out and get new equipment and have liquidity and financing available to them, and to not allow the blanket lien holder to essentially, you know, stranglehold the borrower and not let them do any more financing and not necessarily give them any more money either, but just tie up all their assets with an all-asset lien. And the concept is that the existing lender, the blanket lien holder, for example, isn't disadvantaged by allowing this super priority because but for the purchase money's lender's money, this new item of equipment wouldn't even be there. So there's no harm to the existing lender, it's the concept, and I would agree with that. But the code and the drafters didn't want to have secret liens and have, you know, all these purchase money lenders out there with unrecorded interest and give existing lenders a false sense of security. So that's why you have a filing requirement, and that's why you have a certain time to do it in. Now, if we're talking about a funding source like a leasing company, then you're under this prong of you've got to enable the borrower to acquire the equipment. That's usually a pretty straightforward way of dealing with that issue. Most people in our industry just fund the vendor directly. If you pay the vendor directly, it's pretty clear it's your money that's allowing the borrower to get the interest in the equipment. If you're reimbursing the borrower, it gets trickier, and most people avoid that at all costs. Although there are cases out there, and there is authority, that you know if it's an integrated transaction where yes, the lessee goes and pays the down payment or pays some of it, but they do it knowing and already documenting, hopefully, that the funds were coming from the lender as a reimbursement, that may be close enough. Matter of fact, there's a great case out of New York, the Spartans Motor case, involving Alfredo's prior employer, GE, where this was the holding. But again, it's not the mainstream approach, and you do want to try to avoid it. The possession prong is a lot more difficult. Remember, you have to figure out when the borrower has possession. Now, sometimes you might have a bill of lading or some sort of delivery receipt from an independent third party, and it's really clear, you know, when the equipment was delivered. If you have one of those days, I'd say it's a lucky day. Go out and buy a lottery ticket. That's not kind of the typical situation. Usually you end up with something more complicated. So, for example, what if the equipment is being delivered in stages, a manufacturing facility or something? Or what if it's being tested for a while? It's been there, and they're kind of tweaking it, and there's technicians running around, so the lessee borrower is not ready to buy it yet. Well, do they have possession? And the code actually has some good official commentary on this, saying that the 20-day period begins to run, the clock starts ticking, when it would be apparent to a potential lender that the debtor has acquired an interest in the goods taken as a whole. So when there's a whole bunch of boxes there and they're not put together, the clock's probably not ticking. If it's clear there's performance testing and changing and tweaking and inspections, it's probably not possession yet. There's a really interesting circumstance where you have a rental conversion. This happens a lot with construction equipment, for example. The lessee may have the equipment under rental and then all of a sudden exercise a purchase option and then want to provide or obtain funding for the purchase option. I have some information here in the slide about that. I'm going to skip over it, but if anybody's interested in that situation, let me know. I actually spoke for like a half an hour just on that topic at Alpha back in May, and I find it fascinating, so I'm happy to talk about it, but running a little short on time, so I'm going to skip it. Now, what normally happens is you have an invoice that's more than 20 days old, and you got to figure out what you're doing. And what companies do in our industry is they try to set up a well-defined set of internal policies, try to get a sense of if you're in that window, and also how you can prove later you're in that window if you're in litigation. So, for example, you're always getting a lessee to sign an acceptance certificate or something, saying the equipment's in good operating order and they're accepting it. Adding something to that acceptance certificate where the lessee or borrower is telling you, and I've not had it for more than 15 days or 20 days or something. It's a little self-serving potentially, but it is signed by a third party, and if you're not having a bill of lading, then maybe the trustee in bankruptcy is not going to be able to dig up those documents either. So that is something that's useful. For really expensive equipment or something, you might have a formal policy of actual third-party written verification, maybe over a certain transaction size. A lot of people will use verbal or email verification from the vendor when they can get it. If they do a verbal verification, whoever's doing that will internally document the file, date, time, who they talk to, et cetera. But the point is you come up with a policy to try to put a box around this concept. For the captive finance companies listening on the call, we have a few of them, you have better relationships with your dealers and therefore may be able to come up with policies that are even more likely to have you fall in this basket. Leasing companies on the line that have vendor programs or something like that as well, that's another area where you can sometimes deal with these issues. Really quickly on cross-collateralization, common credit requirement is that all facilities are cross-collateralized. You got to bear in mind that your purchase money priority is only for the purchase money obligation, so it doesn't give you the priority interest on the other stuff that's being cross-collateralized for you. That lien falls wherever those are. It used to be that having some purchase money obligation and some non-purchase money obligation would kill your purchase money. It was called the transformation rule, and you would have no purchase money. That is not the case anywhere now. Article 9 makes clear that you can have purchase money debt and non-purchase money debt, you know, with the same collateral. If you do that, this slide talks about, this slide talks about a concept where you can actually draft and apply where the debt is being repaid. It's really helpful in your documents to have the debt applied first to non-purchase money obligations. That way, if you're later in the term, then what's left at the time as a default is the purchase money obligation, giving you the purchase money priority. That's a little trick that's worth considering. And then refinancings, reconsolidations, restructurings. What happens if you have purchase money obligations and you start, you know, putting them all together in a restructuring of some sort, where you just, you know, change your document set and you pay off the first set with a new set of documents? What happens? Well, Article 9 makes clear that a purchase money security interest does not lose its status even if it's been renewed, refinanced, consolidated, or restructured. But you have to kind of pay attention to what's happening. For example, if you're taking out another lender that had a purchase money obligation, you're paying that lender off, you're signing new documents, and there's a very strong argument that you're not having the same purchase money obligation. You've got a new obligation of funds used to repay a loan. You don't have an obligation of funds used to enable the borrower to acquire the equipment. However, if you took assignment of that other transaction first and then immediately amended and restated it and said it's the same purchase money obligation as was originally there, well, now you have a much stronger argument. So people using progress payment agreements, interim funding agreements, these are concepts you want to think about with your documentation, because you want to make sure when you do your takeout financing, you're keeping your purchase money priority. Okay, Alfredo?
Okay. I'm gonna address a particular type of purchase money security interest, and that's a security interest in inventory. Section 9324B of the UCC provides that you will have a priority security interest over everyone else in inventory if you follow the four steps below. And what that means is that with respect to that inventory, your security interest would be prior to anybody else's, even a prior lien holder, in which usually it's a blanket lien holder. You'll have a prior security interest not only in the inventory, but also in any chattel paper related to that inventory, any proceeds, and any cash proceeds that are received from a buyer of that inventory, so long as those cash proceeds are identifiable and are received prior to the buyer receiving the inventory. Right, but what do you have to do? There's some very special rules, and it's important that you follow these rules. And I'm gonna tell you an interesting story that happened in a situation that involved a firm that I was with a few years ago. But basically, the purchase money security interest must be perfected. Your purchase money security interest in the inventory must be perfected when the debtor receives possession of the inventory, right? And what people often do and what I generally recommend is this. When I'm doing a financing involving a purchase money security interest in inventory, usually the day before or very close to the time we're actually going to close, we will file the UCC in the inventory, identifying sort of what the, and describing the inventory. Right? So the UCC will be in place so that at the time that we actually do the funding, the debtor receives rights in the inventory and grants our security interest, we will already perfect it, usually prior to the debtor receiving the possession of the inventory. That's number one. Number two, the purchase money secured party sends an authenticated notification to the holder of conflicting security interests. This means that you must do a UCC check prior to you doing the funding. And for anyone that has a security interest in inventory or in the debtor, you need to notify them in advance, as provided in number four below, that you are expecting to do a purchase money security interest, expecting to receive a purchase money security interest in inventory and describing the inventory pursuant to financing you're about to provide to the buyer, right? So And you have to send that letter out. It has to be signed. It has to be authenticated. And it could be e-signed or it has to be an authenticated signed notice to the people who have interest in inventory of the debtor. What I generally recommend, just it's a bit overkill, I admit it, is that I'll look at all the various secured parties in my UCC search. And unless there's just an enormous number of people who have security interests involving that debtor, I will send it to everybody. Just send to everybody, just in case someone who thinks they have a security interest in equipment actually has a security interest in inventory, I don't want to have to get into the fight. If they've received the notice, you're fine. Okay? That notice is good for 5 years. So once you've sent the notice out, then for the next 5 years, if you've notified them that you're doing financing of inventory and you may be doing future financings of inventory, then you don't have to notify them again, so long as it's purchasing one securities interest in the inventory. The conflicting security interest holder must receive the notification within 5 years. That's what number three is all about. I have an interesting situation where some years ago, my firm represented someone who was a creditor that had a blanket lien on the debtor's property, and indeed, there was someone who had done a significant purchase money financing in inventory for that debtor who was now in bankruptcy, and they had failed to send the notice, and as a result, they came behind the blanket lien holder. So that's something that's near and dear to my heart and something you should certainly keep in mind. There are some specialized types of equipment also that we should talk about that aren't necessarily governed by filing under Article 9. And this would be equipment that's covered by certificates of title. You know, vehicles, motorized vehicles for sure, aircraft would be something else, vessels, things of that nature. And UCC sections 9303C and 9311A basically provide that in those situations involving equipment that has certificates of title, then the certificate of title laws of the jurisdiction that has authority over that equipment is the place where you look. And so with respect to vehicles, it's usually the state law. With respect to things like aircraft and vessels, there are federal statutes that govern security interests in aircraft and in vessels. All right. There are some unique aspects surrounding these types of equipment that we should consider. Take motor vehicles, for example. Leasing and subleasing, right? Oftentimes, these types of equipment are involved in subleasing. You have to be careful here because if you are the lender in a lease/sublease situation, you want to make sure that if the time should arise where you need to repossess your equipment, either because there's a bankruptcy of the lessee or there's a default under the lease, that the sublessee also has to relinquish possession of the property. Otherwise, under typical quiet enjoyment provisions in documents, if the sublessee is performing, then you might be able to foreclose out the interest of the lessee, but you may not be able to get to the equipment because the sublessee has not defaulted under its agreement. So you'd like to have provisions in your document that provide that any subleasing of the equipment, the sublease will be subject and subordinate to the rights of the lessor, or if there's a lender, to the rights of a lender in connection with that types of equipment, right? The other thing is that, and I'm gonna let Ken talk about this because he has some experience here, where you have a couple of states where the certificate of title laws may not override. Ken, why don't you just take a time to tell us about Idaho, Illinois, and Louisiana?
And actually, as I'm looking, it looks like we're coming to the end of our session. So maybe this will be a teaser. If you have any deals in these states, there are some unusual issues. There are other title vehicle issues that we've listed on this page. And as you can tell, Alfredo and I love to talk about this stuff and maybe talk too fast or too long. But we hope you've enjoyed it. And please, please contact us after getting these slides, or if there's anything in here that we didn't talk about that you're interested in, or if you have any questions about what we said before. But I think we're out of time, and we really appreciate everybody attending and hope it was useful.